It's the first Sunday of Lent, and I want to present you with a profound theological observation. God likes you. Hey, y'all, before we go too much further, time for shameless plug of our Lenten devotionals. We take a lot of pride in putting these together as a community, and it's our gift. It's our offering to you. You can find them online. You can also request, while we still have supplies, of an actual tangible copy that you can hold and read as you do your own reflection time and prayer during Lent. And our favorite page is always this page here that shows all the many faces and the folks that are involved in sharing their voice with you this Lent. So join us as we journey together. And our reflections for this first week of Lent, my heart was really drawn towards the gospel lesson from Mark 1. Always when we come into Lent, there's a focus around the baptism and the temptation of Jesus in the wilderness. Mark also gives us the powerful proclamation of Jesus, declaring the kingdom of God and calling us to repent and pledge our allegiance to that good news. And that's really where my heart was drawn. And the first part for me that was an important meditation is to ground ourselves in the baptismal imagery. Before we go any further into Lent, before we hear that proclamation and that call to turn and to change our hearts and lives, we have to have a sense of who are we in the eyes of God. And I think for many of us who've heard a lot of preaching and maybe even been on the other side of a lot of finger-pointing and feared a lot of hellfire and damnation, it's important to realize that not only does God love us, but as I heard in a conversation with a friend of mine, a discovery that was important for him, God likes us. The language that is spoken over Jesus, the voice that comes from heaven that says to Jesus, "You are my child, you are my beloved, in you I delight, in you I find pleasure, in you I discover my happiness." That same language needs to be applied to each and every one of us as Jesus signs for us what it is to truly be human. As my friend said, "Okay, God loves me. I've heard it so often that I kind of assume it's God's obligation, right? It's who God is. It's what God does. God loves me." But it really changed the way my friend thought about himself to begin to imagine what it would be like if God liked him. And I want to offer that to you. I think we live so often in the sense that, yeah, God loves me because, you know, God has to. God loves everybody, and I guess I'm in that demographic somewhere. But surely God looks at my life and is disappointed. And I want to tell you, that's not true. God looks upon us, God's creatures, and God delights in us. We are the source of God's joy. It's for joy, the writer of Hebrews says, that Jesus endured the shame and the suffering of the cross. God likes us as human beings. And if we're to be bold enough to claim that about our own identity, that God sees us as worthy, as more than enough, in contradiction to all the voices around us that tell us, no, we're not enough, or even the voices in our own heads that tell us, no, you're not good enough. The voice of God breaks through to us, and I invite you this season to allow God to say to you, perhaps tenderly, perhaps in a sweet whisper, that God not only loves you, but God likes you and delights in you. Now, where we go from that is if that is true for me, then it has to be true for every other human being. God loves and delights in all of creation. We're all created in God's image. Part of the language of the temptation of Jesus in the wilderness is that he's doing battle with the devil. Well, that's fine. That's important language for us because there is evil in this world. There are powers and principalities. There are systems that are arrayed against us as human beings. Yeah, we sin. Yeah, we fall short. And that's a big part of what Lent is about, is acknowledging that truth and being honest with ourselves. But being a sinner isn't my total reality. And the truth is, it's not the total reality of anyone else. Jesus fought the devil, but he wasn't fighting human beings. Now, he came in conflict with the powers that be. There were a lot of folks that aligned themselves against Jesus, but Jesus kept a clear focus. And in our culture, we have such a tendency to demonize other human beings. That's not what God wants for us. Rather, we need to humanize one another. We need to look at one another and see the beloved child of God. We need to look at one another and see the one who's created in God's good and lovely image. And yes, find a human being that God, in fact, delights in and takes joy. We need to recover that. I'm not talking about not having tough love. We practice that in our community. A lot of times, we simply agree to disagree. That's the only way you're going to have an honest conversation is if folks can actually get on the table and say what they think without fear of repercussion. Now, that doesn't mean that we don't have accountability. Yeah, we do. We have to tell the truth. We pointedly disagree. We passionately disagree. But it's all in the pursuit of love. And yes, some relationships become so broken that there's a need for distance. We sometimes talk about the old Southern saying that sometimes you got to love somebody, but you do it with a long-handled spoon. Sometimes we have to practice that reality in our community. But if it's tough love, it's still love. We can't fight other people as if they're devils. They're flesh and blood. They're beloved, just like us. They're sinners, just like us. And so as we face this call of Jesus to repent, to change our hearts and lives, I plead with us this year, begin in a sense of God's love for you, God's delight in you. Embrace it. Allow yourself to imagine God's love and delight for other human beings, even our enemies. And then embrace the call to change. If we want to see change in this world, we need to be change in this world. We need to embody it. Jesus not only proclaimed the kingdom of God, as Jürgen Moltmann said, Jesus was the kingdom of God in person. We need to bear witness to that with our lives, humbly, telling the truth, being honest, admitting our shortcomings and our weaknesses, telling the truth when we fall short, but also resisting the powers that oppress. We need to take a stand against Christian nationalism. We need to take a stand against white supremacy. There are a lot of idols in our nation that we bow down to, even in the church. And this Lent is an opportunity for us to begin to make the change. So I invite you, sisters and brothers, may God create change in we, God's beloved creatures, this Lent.